Hello and welcome to number two in this short series dealing with old calculations from past paper questions. Here we look at a question involving ammonia cleaner, and this is a titration question where we are required to work out the concentration of ammonia in the cleaner, ammonia being an alkali. In the second question, which in fact you'll see is actually several questions in one. One of the things that we'll be doing, we'll be looking at the potassium hydroxide present in soap. But I have added on a few other snippets of questions as well. Let's make a start. Pause the slide and reflect on this information. So what's this warning to do with? Well, ammonia is a poisonous, pungent gas, sometimes known as nappy gas because it's given off from the very young baby's nappies during the first few weeks. And clearly, if we're working with ammonia solution, we need to use a fume cupboard and make sure that we have good ventilation. Now, if it's dilute ammonia, and given that it's present in a household cleaner, clearly in this particular case where it's dilute, so long as the room is reasonably ventilated, we should be able to work with it okay. Ammonia is present in a cleaner because alkalis are good at attacking grease, dissolving grease, and ammonia is an alkali. It would be described as a weak alkali, pH of around 9. So it will be good at attacking surfaces with a small amount of dirt and grease. Things like window cleaner, it may be, it won't always be, but it may be the active ingredient in a particular window cleaning agent. It may be the active ingredient in something used to clean the worktops in a kitchen. And just while we're looking at the use of alkalis to dissolve grease, let's take a look at two others that you may come across in your own home: washing soda and caustic soda. Washing soda is hydrated sodium carbonate, bought in the supermarket in the form of crystals. I would describe it as fairly strong, a moderately strong alkali, pH of around 11 perhaps. You will have come across it perhaps as a water softener, where it's used to precipitate the ions causing hardness out of the water, namely calcium and magnesium. When sodium carbonate is added, a precipitation reaction takes place that produces the insoluble carbonates of those two metals. So having precipitated those out of the water is no longer hard. It will have the sodium ions in it still, but sodium ions in the water do not cause hardness, hence the water has been softened. In terms of its alkaline properties, here's one example of where sodium carbonate is used. It is used in swimming pools because when they use chlorine to kill the germs, the chlorine has the side effect of making the water acidic. So sodium carbonate is added in a measured amount to neutralize the acidity produced by the chlorine. Chlorine, of course, dissolves in water to produce a mixture of two acids, hydrochloric acid and hypochlorous acid. And then a strong alkali, which again can be purchased in the supermarket, caustic soda. This consists of crystals of sodium hydroxide, strongly alkaline, strongly corrosive. This might be used in your home to unblock a drain where someone perhaps has accidentally emptied grease down the plug hole of the sink. Where you've got thick grease, then you need obviously a very strong alkali to attack it at a reasonable rate. But you can see here that sodium hydroxide has many industrial uses. It's used in the production of paper, it's used in the production of textiles, the production of detergents as well. And it's the active ingredient in many oven cleaners where you need to get thick baked on grease removed. Okay, we're picking up a little bit of general chemistry as we go through, and there's no harm in that. Returning to the mole question. So the student tested the liquid and found its pH in this case to be 12. So 12 is bordering on weak strong. Suggest how the student would have measured the pH. What would you use? Yeah, universal indicator paper. It will tell us not only whether it's acid or alkaline, but it'll give us an indication of the pH value. Most pH universal indicator paper will indicate only up to pH 12, so once you get to pH 12, the colour won't change to distinguish between 13 and 14. But you could use universal indicator in this instance, and it would turn a dark purple or indigo colour. Next question here. What conclusion would the student have made from the observation? Well, I've said cleaner is weakly alkaline. I think if the pH came out to be 12, I would describe that as certainly moderately, if not strongly alkaline. Strongly alkaline would be in the range 12, 13 to 14. So not terribly happy referring to it as weakly. Now, the student decided to find out if the contents agreed with those given on the table using the method given below. So what the student did here was to take 100 cubic centimetres of the household cleaner, active ingredient ammonia, and put it into one of these volumetric flasks. This one measures 1,000 cubic centimetres, or which is a litre in the old-fashioned term, what we now call a cubic decimeter, one cubic decimeter. So the 100 was placed in here. It would have come up to something like about here, I suppose. And then water was added to bring it up to exactly total volume of 1,000 cubic centimeters. And a volumetric flask has got only one calibration, somewhere here in the neck. So possibly here you'll see a little circle, engraved circle on the glass. And it would have been filled up to exactly that level. What have you got? You've put 100 in 1,000. So how much ammonia is present in this total volume of 1,000? The answer is 100 in 1,000, which is 1 in 10. It's been diluted tenfold. Now pause this slide and reflect upon this information and gather your facts together. Okay, so we have a titration taking place here. We've got our burette. Below that we'd have a conical flask. Below that we'd have a white tile. Now, 10 cubic centimetres of the diluted ammonia solution was put in here. So don't get mixed up in the 10's come up twice here. We've diluted it tenfold. Created a total of 1,000 cubic centimetres. We've removed 10 cubic centimetres from that volumetric flask. So we have a total here of 1,000 cubic centimetres. This is of the ammonia solution. Now, we've removed 10 cubic centimetres from that. We took out 10 cubic centimetres. But as you'll see, what we're determining actually is the concentration. So we're going to find the concentration. It wouldn't have mattered had we taken 20 or 25 or 50 for that matter. The concentration that we would work out using the appropriate mathematics would turn out to be the same. I'm emphasizing this because I don't want you, there is a possible confusion regarding this 10. It's quite separate from the fact that we've diluted the ammonia cleaner by taking 100 and diluting it up to a total volume of 1,000. In this particular case, the 10 is only going to be relevant for the next minute or two while we work out the concentration. We're going to work out the concentration of the ammonia present in this solution. Okay, so what are the key figures? You know that in a titration, and we'll be doing one in a moment here, in any titration there are 6 variables, as is represented by this formula here that you may have seen me use before. The 6 variables are there: C1, V1, C2, V2, and the number of moles of 1 in the balanced equation, and the number of moles of 2 in the balanced equation. 6 variables in all. And typically what happens is you are given 5 of these variables, and your job is to work out the 6th one. In this case, what we're trying to work out is the concentration of the ammonia solution, which in this case is the alkaline. You may be aware as well that when it comes to this equation, a typical reaction between an acid and an alkali, we assign 1 to one of the chemicals and 2 to the other. It doesn't really matter which. It just makes it a little bit simpler if we assign 1 to the chemical that we require information about. Now, we need information here about the ammonia, which is the alkali. So I'll be referring to the alkali as chemical 1 and the acid as chemical 2. That means that the C1 is the concentration of the ammonia solution, and V1 is the volume of the ammonia solution, and so forth. Number of moles 1 is the number of moles of the ammonia, the alkali, in the balanced equation. Okay, so let's go back and collect our information. Again, I said to you we're going to call the alkali chemical 1 and the acid chemical 2. Now, for that reason, in terms of C1 and V1, we're talking here about the ammonia. And you'll see that from this, we had 10 cubic centimeters. We took 10 cubic centimeters of the ammonia solution from the volumetric flask. In terms of V2, that was the volume of acid required in the titration. According to this, 5 cubic centimeters was needed. In fact, this seems to be a mistake here because I see 25 down here. It should be 25 cubic centimeters was needed. In terms of the concentration of the ammonia, well, that's what we're trying to get. We don't know C1. In terms of the concentration of the acid, that's C2, we're given that figure as 0.2 up here. 0.2 moles per cubic decimeter. So we have 3 of the 5 figures. What about the remaining 2? Well, this refers to the balanced equation. How many moles of chemical 1, which I've chosen to be the alkali, ammonia, how many moles of it in the balanced equation? Again, remember, if there's no number here, it's taken to be 1. So there's 1 mole of ammonia. How many moles of chemical 2, the acid? Again, this is taken to be 1. So in each case, it's 1. So we're ready to take this information now and calculate the concentration of the ammonia. But typically of these questions, they take you through it in part. So let's do it bit by bit. Okay. Now, in fact, this one hasn't taken us through separate bits, so I'm going to make use of this equation here. So you have all your figures. You could either rearrange this equation to give C1 what we're requiring, C1 in terms of the others, or for some you may find it simpler to put in your values and then work it out from there. If you're good at rearranging equations, this is what you do. You're looking for C1 on its own on this side. You would like it to be there on its own. Problem is, you've got V1 here. You've also got C2 and V2. If I was to multiply the left-hand side by C2 times V2, that would allow me to cancel that and that. And if I was to divide it by V1, that would allow me to cancel that with that. And there's a rule in mathematics. So long as you do the same to both sides of the equation, you haven't made any net change. So I'm going to do exactly that. C2 V2 over V1 is equal to C1. Or, in simple terms, it's going to be C2 times V2 times mole 1, mole's a chemical one, divided by, sorry, this has disappeared on me here, this should of course say V1 here, divided by V1 times mole 2, moles of chemical 2 in the balanced equation. Either way, you can either put the numbers directly in here and work it out that way, or rearrange it first and work it out that way. Have a go and see what you get. So pause the slide for a moment. Well, here you see I have rearranged the equation, as I've shown you. I've put in the five values that I had. Value for this will be the value here for the number of moles of number of 1, which I assigned to the ammonia. This is the number of moles in the balanced equation of the acid. C2 is the concentration of the acid. V2 the volume of acid used in the required in the titration from the burette. And V1 was the volume of the ammonia solution that we took. And this gives us a concentration of 0.5 moles per cubic decimeter. Do recall that at the start we took 100 cubic centimeters of the household product and added water to make it up to a total volume of 1,000 cubic centimeters in the volumetric flask, diluting it by a factor of 10. Just to make sure this has been worked out. The concentration then, we would have to multiply this by 10 to get the original concentration, so it would be 10 times 0.5, which gives us 5.0 mole per cubic decimeter. It's worth pointing out that ammonia is an extremely soluble chemical. About 1,000 cubic centimeters of ammonia will dissolve in just 1 cubic centimeter of water. So we know at this stage that the concentration is 5 mole per cubic decimeter. And here we're being required to work out the concentration in grams per cubic decimeter. So could you change the moles here into grams? Pause the snapcast and have a go at this. Remember how we change using this rearrangement diagram here? At the moment we've got moles of ammonia, we'd like to change it into mass. This is the relationship here between mole and mass. Diluted. You worked out the concentration to be 5 moles per cubic decimeter. The relative molecular mass of ammonia, NH3, made up of the 14 for the nitrogen and 3 ones or 3 for the 3 hydrogens, giving a total of 17. 1 mole of ammonia, 1 mole, would be 17 grams. So 5 moles would be 5 times 17, which gives us an answer 85 grams per cubic decimeter. Can you suggest a possible cause, other than the experimental error, of the difference between the value from the student's experiment and that given on the label? I didn't draw attention to that, in the original stem of the question. Not sure I have a note of it here. Looks like I possibly left that out. The bottle would state that it contains a certain number of grams per cubic decimeter. I'm led to conclude here then that the value is different, that possibly the most likely thing here is that the concentration that the student has determined is lower than that stated on the bottle. So can you come up with any explanations? Ammonia and other alkaline solutions absorb carbon dioxide from the air. As they absorb the carbon dioxide, they also react with it, forming, for example, in this case, ammonium carbonate. So the manufacture of the product would inform us, if we complained, that the longer the product is left exposed to the atmosphere, the lower the concentration of ammonia, for a number of reasons. The fact that we can smell the ammonia when we open the bottle is an indication that it's slowly but surely leaving the solution. And the fact that ammonia dissolves carbon dioxide and possibly other gases in the air would be another explanation for why the concentration has fallen from the time it was manufactured. So this ends question number 3, the first question in this particular snapcast. Let's go on to question 4, which you'll see is in, I think, 3 different bits that are not necessarily related. So this is really perhaps 3 separate questions. But what's important is that you're learning the skills. So pause the slide here and gather your information. So now is the time to work out the differences in these values. How will we get the mass of hydrated salt? Well, if you take the mass of the crucible away from the mass of the crucible and the crystals, that should give us the mass of the hydrated salt. And if we take the mass of the crucible away from the mass of anhydrous salt, plus the crucible, that will give us the mass, this particular mass, the mass of anhydrous salt. And then, of course, if we subtract these two values, that'll give us the mass of water. And here are the answers that I came up with. So here we have the masses of all the chemicals we need, these being the two most important chemicals. Before we get there, what is meant by water of crystallization? Write down your definition. And this is what is expected. Water molecules locked up inside the ionic crystals. Water molecules locked up inside the ionic crystals. Strange term this, to be locked up, but that's what's used. What about this second question? Describe how the pupil could be certain that all of the water of crystallization has been removed from the crystals. We did come across this earlier in question 1 and or 2. Did you come up with this answer? You would heat, cool and weigh, and heat, cool and weigh, and keep doing that repeatedly. Until what? Until there's no further decline in mass. This shows that all the water of crystallization has been removed. What we do then is we heat and weigh over and over till we reach a constant mass. Okay, we're going to take this information now that we had a moment ago. We're going to use the information to calculate the value of X here in the formula for the hydrated zinc sulphate. Once again, the central unit in chemistry is the mole, and we'll need to convert these values here into moles of the zinc sulphate and moles of water. And we're going to work out then a ratio between the anhydrous zinc sulphate and the water, and that ratio will indeed give us the value of X. So maybe you'd like to pause the snapcast and get underway with that yourself. So the mass of anhydrous salt was 1.68 grams. How many moles did you get for that? Sorry, we'll go back and try this together ourselves. So we've got zinc sulfate. We're going to have to work out what one mole would weigh. We have here the relative atomic masses. That's got one zinc, which is 65. How many sulfurs? One sulfur, which is 32. How many oxygens? Yeah, four oxygens. That's 416, 64. So we've got 4, 6, 11, 1, 7, 10, 161 it seems to come out to be. How will we work out the number of moles? We've got the mass and we've got the relative molecular mass. Do you recall that mole is given as the mass divided by the relative molecular mass? So this will be the mass, 1.68, divided by 161. And that comes out to be 0.0104 mole. Okay, let's move on to the next one, where we work out this time the number of moles of water. So we've got 1.31 grams. Water, the formula is H2O. To work out its RMM, we'll have 2 times hydrogen, each contributing 1 to the mass. And we have 1 oxygen contributing a mass of 16. The relative molecular mass of water is 18. Again, we know that moles is given by the number of grams, the mass divided by the relative molecular mass. This is 1.31 divided by 18 this time, which is, and this comes out to be 0.073 according to my calculator. So we've got the number of moles of the two chemicals, 0.0104. To transfer this information over, where we now work out the ratio, 0.0104 moles of that, and of water 0.073. Now, how do we get these to become integers? I advised you the last time what we do is we always divide by the smaller of the numbers. This number is clearly smaller. So divide both of these numbers by 0.0104. And that will clearly give us a ratio 1 to 6.99, etc. So 1 to 7. In other words, for every 1 mole of zinc sulfate, we have 7 moles of water. Water of crystallisation. So this gives us the value of X up here then is 7, and the formula is zinc sulfate, ZnSO4 dot 7H2O, and that is known as a heptahide rate. Heptagon is a 7-sided figure, and this is known as zinc sulfate heptahide rate. Okay, that's the first of 3 parts. I have to say completely different parts, I think, to question 2. So let's go to the next part. This is the fourth question. We covered two on the first snapcast. Okay, so an experiment was carried out to determine the solubility of potassium nitrate over a range of temperatures. You may recall, perhaps from a different snapcast that I made, that I referred to the solubility unit as being an unusually difficult unit. Quite often, units are what I would call maybe double barrel, like for example, we talk about speed in terms of miles per hour. Now this solubility unit is unusually difficult because the unit of solubility is the number of grams of salt that dissolves in 100 grams of water at a particular temperature. Now, this graph shows the number of grams of salt dissolving in 100 grams of water at a range of temperatures, as we see here on the x-axis. Let's see what we're required to do. Well, in fact, first thing we're asked to do is, what is the maximum mass of potassium nitrate which could be dissolved in 50 grams of water? Well, there's a problem for a start, because our graph is based correctly on 100 grams of water. But if we could find out the solubility in 100 grams of water, then all we've got to do is half that. So I'm going to go to the graph here and find out the solubility at 30 degrees centigrade. So we're going to go to this graph, find 30 degrees centigrade, which is here somewhere, and we'll go way up here, straight line, and then we'll come across here and read off the solubility. And I've tried doing this, but without having lined paper, this is only an approximation. And you must be seen to do this with a ruler. The marker of your paper will want to see exactly what you've done. So you can see here, I've gone at what I think is about 30, maybe slightly lower than 30 as I look at it now. But we go up here till we hit the graph, the line, and we come across then at right angles, and we read off here the solubility. And according to this, 42 grams dissolves in 100 grams of water. And of course, we were asked for the solubility in 50 grams of water, so all we need to do is half that, and it would be 21 grams that would dissolve in 50 grams of water at 30 degrees centigrade. Remember, we work from 30 here. Again, I emphasize that I do not have the benefit of lined paper here, so this has just been, at best, a close approximation to the answer. Again, I did remind you that markers will want to see you using rulers and pencils and doing it properly. And the answer we came up with was 21 grams. 21 grams will dissolve in 50 grams of water at 30 degrees C. Pause the slide again and consider how we would do this. So again, we're dealing with what mass of potassium nitrate would crystallize out when a solution containing 50 grams of solid dissolved in 50 grams of water 75 degrees C is cooled to 30 degrees C. Now, I'm going to presume at this stage that when we put 50 grams of salt into 50 grams of water, that the solution isn't saturated. We'd have to look at this in a moment. The first thing I need to do is to equate this to 100 grams. If 50 grams dissolve in 50 grams of water, and our solubility graph is based on 100 grams of water, what is that equivalent to? Well, we've doubled the water, we would expect double the mass of salt. So 100 grams, we would expect that this person has the equivalent of 100 grams and 100 grams of water. The key thing here is that the temperature is going to fall from 75 down to 30. So let's return to the graph again. Now, again, I don't have the benefit of lined paper. But in fact, I can see here that the solubility at 75, we saw there. Solubility of 75, we get from here, I reckon this is about 70, so I've gone to 75 here. And we head straight up, we use a ruler and pencil here, make this clear to the examiner. We hit the line and then we come across and we read off the solubility, which I have taken to be about 144, not having the benefit of lined paper here. Now, they had 50 grams dissolved in 50 grams of water. The actual mass they had dissolved, remember, was 100 grams then. 50 grams of salt and 50 grams of water would be the equivalent of 100 grams in 100 grams of water. Now, when they cooled it to a temperature, the same temperature we had a moment ago, which was 30 degrees centigrade. And at 30, we'd already established that the solubility was 42 grams. It wasn't saturated. It could have taken up to 148, we see here. It had 50 grams of salt and 50 grams of water, or it had the equivalent of 100 grams of salt to begin with. When it was cooled, it fell to an equivalent of having 42 grams in 100 grams of water. Now, if 42 grams of salt dissolves in 100 grams of water, how much would dissolve in half that volume of water? Yes, 21 grams. The rest would have crystallized out. The difference between the 100 that they started with, well, in fact, based on 50 grams of water, that was 50 grams they started with. They started with 50 grams of salt and 50 grams of water. They ended up with 21 grams in 50 grams of water. And as a result then, 29 grams would have crystallized out. Hope we've answered the question. Okay, let's go on to the next part. So, pause the slide here, have a look at this, and consider how you would answer this. So, what happens as the temperature of the water rises? Does the solubility of nitrogen increase in the same manner that salts would behave? No, in fact, it's the opposite. As the water gets warmer, it dissolves less nitrogen. This is the unit here, cubic centimeters dissolving per 100 cubic centimeters of water. As it rises from, for example, 20, room temperature, up to 30, its solubility falls from 1.63 down to 1.44 cubic centimeters per 100 cubic centimeters of water. Does oxygen do the same? Yes, it does indeed. Again, you see the solubility at room temperature, 3.26, falling by even more to 2.78. I think that's a bigger fall there. So the solubility of oxygen is influenced more by a change in temperature. Okay, let's see what it's going to ask us in this regard. But before we leave this, this is true of all gases. The solubility of gases in water decreases with increase in temperature. It's the opposite to what we see with salts dissolving in water. In that respect, if we take a goldfish bowl, doesn't look anything like a goldfish bowl anyway. Little goldfish in here. I did say it was rubbish at art, but anyway. If we have water, we need to, let's say, replenish or refresh the water in a goldfish bowl. If we take the water and we boil it and cool it back to room temperature quickly and put the goldfish in the goldfish is not going to be very happy, because in boiling the water we will have removed most of the dissolved air, most of the oxygen that would be dissolved naturally in the water, the oxygen that the gills of the goldfish are designed to remove. And probably, I'm not sure, but probably the goldfish would die pretty quickly. You would see it coming up to the surface by way of trying to get the water at the surface, which has already begun to be reoxygenated, but it almost certainly wouldn't get enough and it would die fairly quickly. And yet it is recommended that when you're replacing the water in a goldfish bowl, that you should boil the water, but you should boil it and leave it to cool for overnight or 24 hours. And the reason for this is water coming out of the tap also has chlorine dissolved in it, dissolved in the water treatment plant to kill germs. And the chlorine is bad for the goldfish. So if we boil the water, and maybe boil it, actually keep it boiling for a few minutes, we will boil out all of the air, or most of the air, and we'll boil out most or all of the chlorine. Now if we let it cool overnight, the good thing about it is that the air will begin to redissolve back into the water. And that water will be perfect then for the goldfish. Again, pause the slide and consider how to undertake this. This again was my response. The next question. Suggest how the composition of air dissolved in water might differ from atmospheric air. Explain your answer. Which is more soluble, nitrogen or oxygen? Well, let's take it at room temperature to begin with. Does more nitrogen or more oxygen dissolve? More oxygen dissolves. In fact, roughly speaking, twice as much oxygen at room temperature. So the normal composition of air would be that we have a fifth, about this much, is oxygen, and the rest of this is nitrogen. So because oxygen is more soluble than nitrogen in water, I would expect that it might be something like this. There's going to be more, a higher percentage of oxygen in water at room temperature. Not sure if that's reflected at other temperatures, but certainly, yeah, there. Again, it's roughly double. Let's go up to 30. Yeah, it's almost double again. So, in general, these two pie charts here reflect the fact that the percentage of oxygen is represented by the dissolved air in water is much greater than it is in terms of its composition in normal air. This was the question here. And in terms of the explanation, you would quote figures from the table that illustrate the fact that at any particular temperature, about twice as much oxygen appears to dissolve in water. And that's good for the goldfish. Okay. Again, pause the slide here and have a go at this. So a few degrees change in the temperature, rise in the temperature in particular, look what happens. This is the solubility of oxygen. Well, water, I suppose, in a river might more typically be around this temperature, 3.55 grams. And if some industry carelessly releases a large volume of waste hot water into a small stream, for example, it may raise the temperature by tens of degrees centigrade. The solubility, the amount of oxygen dissolved in the water, will fall. And so the kind of response I think they're looking for here, again, would be something like this. Solubility of oxygen falls as temperature rises, and with too little dissolved oxygen in the water, fish and other wildlife in the water will suffer adversely. And that ends, well, that should say there that it ends question 4, I think, was it B? And here's a 4C, again, completely different question, really. Let's see how you get on with this. Another titration question. So we've got potassium hydroxide, KOH. It's a waste product in the manufacture of soap. To make a soap, what we do is we take a fat or an oil, and we boil it with an alkali, something like sodium hydroxide, or looks like they may be using potassium hydroxide here, some strong alkali. And if you boil those, that produces a soap. It also produces an alcohol, not the kind of alcohol we drink, but a member of the same family. And I presume this is where the potassium hydroxide, the waste potassium hydroxide, is being produced. Concentration of the solution, we're told, is approximately 0.1 mole per cubic decimeter, but we're being asked to work it out accurately. Now, the industry that's dealing with this wouldn't be allowed to be dumping alkali into a river. It would have to treat it, and if it's going to treat it economically, it would need to know accurately the concentration of the potassium hydroxide typically in the water, in the effluent, and thereby know the amount of acid to treat it with, to neutralize it. Now, it's necessary to find the exact concentration using of the potassium hydroxide. They use nitric acid, which has the formula HNO3, and we're told that its concentration is 0.1 mole per cubic decimeter. So the facts: potassium hydroxide is the problem. We're neutralizing it with nitric acid, and the concentration of the nitric acid is 0.1. That's the key information we've got from this particular page. You're asked to write a balance symbol equation. Could you have done this? Potassium hydroxide, for example, made up of potassium in group 1. Potassium's being in group 1 is a single positive ion. Hydroxide is a compound ion. You'd need to look that up on the back of your periodic table on the data sheet. It's a single minus ion. That's why it's KOH. Nitric acid, in a separate snapcast, I told you that all acids have a second name, beginning with hydrogen. What is nitric acid's alternative name? Yeah, hydrogen nitrate, made up of the hydrogen ion, which is H+. And the nitrate ion, which has a formula NO3. Separately, it has a charge minus. So again, you need one of each of those, which is reflected in these formulae. When they react, you're supposed to know that a base or an alkali, this is an alkali, you should know that an alkali or base will react with an acid and produce what? A salt, and usually water as well. What will the salt be? Well, again, in a separate snapcast, told you that the salt comes in part from the acid. In this case, the nitrate part comes from the acid, and the metal part comes from the alkali or base. In this case, it's the potassium. The remaining two bits, the hydroxide bit there and the hydrogen bit there, they combine to form the water. In terms of balancing the equation, you have 1K on the left, 1 on the right. You have got on the left 3 and 1's 4 oxygens, 1 in the KOH, 3 in the nitric acid, a total of 4. On the right, you've also got four, three there in the nitrate ion, and one in the water. Finally, the hydrogens are balanced. You've got one hydrogen in the KOH, one in the HNO3, that's two. And on the right, you've got two in the water molecule. So everything's balanced there. And in terms of the molar ratios, it's one mole of KOH reacts or is equivalent to one mole of HNO3. We say that they react in equi or equimolar amounts. Some more information we've got here. The nitric acid solution is placed in a burette, and 25 cubic centimeters of potassium hydroxide is transferred to a conical flask. So we've got our conical flask here, and in there we put the 25 cubic centimeters of KOH. Up here we have our burette above, and in the burette what do we have? We've got the nitric acid, HNO3, and we carry out a titration using a suitable indicator. Now, in terms of additional information we've got, 25 cubic centimeters of the alkali is taken. The titer, the volume of acid that is added from the burette, we're told is 22.2. And previously we were given the we were told that the approximate concentration of the potassium hydroxide was, just to go back there a second, .1, and the concentration of the nitric acid was also exactly .1. So we take the only information that's of importance here to add to the information we saw a moment ago is this, that the concentration of the nitric acid was 0.1. So this is 0.1 mole per cubic decimeter. Now, at this stage, you have got all the information you need. Recall how we use that equation, C1V1 over C2V2 equals mole of 1 over mole of 2. Recall how these have 6 different variables and that you are given 5 and asked to work out the remaining one. Now, also recall that what I did in the previous case was I assigned a number to each of the chemicals involved. I assigned a 1 in the last example to the alkali and a 2 to the acid. This one's no different. Once again, the information that's missing is the concentration of the potassium hydroxide, the alkaline. So I would assign the number 1 to the potassium hydroxide and the number 2 to the acid nitric acid. So C1 and V1 and mole 1 will refer to the potassium hydroxide. C2, V2 and mole 2 will refer to the nitric acid. So C1 will be 25.0. I beg your pardon, V1 will be 25.0. C1 is the unknown. The number of moles in the balanced equation, you may recall when we looked at the balanced equation a moment ago, that they react in the ratio 1 mole to 1 mole. C2 is the concentration of the acid, 0.1. V2 is the volume of the acid, 22.2, and moles 2, the number of moles of acid, nitric acid, in the equation is 1. So can you pause the slide and try to determine the value of C1 in moles per cubic decimeter? Here are the stages and answering that question, the balanced equation. I showed you, we put in the various numbers. We've got the KOH in here. We've got the HNO3 in here. We were given the values, all the values for the nitric acid. And the only value we didn't get was the concentration of the potassium hydroxide, and you had to determine that. I had hoped it would have been worked out. It doesn't seem to be so. I don't seem to have done that, so let's go back and see what that comes out to be. So C1, I'm not going to go through the rearrangement again. I did it just in the previous question, so you could go back to look at that. I want C1 on its own on the left, so I multiply by C2 V2 over V1, and I do the same on the right. We end up with mole 1 times C2 V2 all over mole 2 times V1. And now we put all those figures in. Number of moles of 1, which is the potassium hydroxide in the balance equation 1, times C2, that's the concentration of the nitric acid, that's 0.1. Multiplied by V2, the volume of acid that was required, that's 22.2. And that's all divided by number of moles of 2, the nitric acid in the balanced equation was 1, times V1, which is the volume of the alkali, the potassium hydroxide, that's 25.0. And that comes out to be 0.08 repeating, or 0.0. We round that up, that would be to the first significant figure, that would be 0.09. It did say the value, the concentration was approximately 0.1, and that is the case. Pause the slide and have a go at this, please. Okay, we're nearly there. Describe stating precautions to ensure safety and accuracy, how you would transfer the potassium hydroxide solution to the conical flask. And if the potassium hydroxide is in a large container, like a Winchester, where we've got several litres, that represents a heavy bottle, you're going to have to take steps to deal with that as well. So jot down a few points. And this is what you should have come up with, something like this. Put on your safety glasses. Wash a 25 cubic centimeter bulb pipette first with water and then with sodium hydroxide. And I've been through the why in mole question 1 on the previous snapcast. Fill the pipette to the mark using a pipette filler or a pipe pump. The mark I'm referring to would be, it's not a very good sketch of a pipette, but there's only one calibration on a pipette, somewhere in the neck here. You would fill it up to there. And then you would run the potassium hydroxide into the flask, and you mustn't blow for reasons I described before. But I did say if it was in a large container, you would also have to pour it out into a beaker to begin with. But typically there might be 5 steps here and 3 marks, and if you get any 3 of the 5, you'll get all the marks. But make sure that you say more rather than less without saying anything that's wrong. Again, pause the slide and have a go at this. And again, if you did watch the snapcast that ran before this on moles 1 and 2, as part of my response to moles 1, I went through the explanation in good detail, I think. But this is what you should have come up with. So transfer to a beaker first of all. We're dealing with here with quite a big bottle. You shouldn't be taking it directly from the bottle. So now you've got it in a beaker. You'd have your safety glasses on. You'd put a funnel into the burette, which is currently on a clamp stand. You should bring the clamp stand down onto a stool so that you're not reaching way up into the above your head with corrosive chemicals. and using a funnel to avoid spillages, you'd pour the nitric acid from the beaker into the burette, just a little bit to begin with, and you would rinse the burette, including the jet. Remember, the jet is that bit below the stopcock, this little bit here. You rinse it first with distilled water, and then with the solution you're putting in it, including the jet each time, and then you'd fill it up with the nitric acid itself, including the jet, and making sure that you have a continuous column of nitric acid from the top of the burette right through to the tip of the jet. Then you fill the burette and record the initial reading. You're expected to record the reading to two decimal places, where the second figure after the decimal point is either a 0 or a 5. These would be examples here. 22.45, 18.20. On some occasions, it may be acceptable to give it to just one decimal place. Now, pause the slide here and have a go at the final titration calculation. So this particular one is a slight variation. Have a look at this. The concentration then, we're looking for the concentration of the potassium hydroxide. Is this the one we did? Sorry, I'm a bit confused here. This is the one I solved a moment ago with you. And we have the answer to that. Let's just go back to see where I had that. This is where we solved that one earlier. Is that the same question? Let's see. It's 22.2. Just bear with me for a moment. Yeah, same question. So, in fact, we've got that bit done, part two, and that was 2 g/cu/dm. Could you do that? Remember that in terms of its concentration in moles per cubic decimeter, it turned out to be down here at the bottom, 0.088. Now, because we're taking this figure forward, I would not take the rounded up figure, but the more accurate figure, 0.0 with 8 repeating. I'm having trouble finding the location of this. So the concentration was 0.0888 mole per cubic decimeter. Could you now finally change that into a concentration expressed in grams per cubic decimeter? The formula of potassium hydroxide is KOH. Working out its relative molecular mass, you have one potassium, which is 39. You have one oxygen, which is 16. And one hydrogen, which is 1. So that comes out to be 56 altogether. So 1 mole is 56 grams. This number of moles would be 0.0888 times 56 grams per cubic decimeter. And that comes out, I believe, to be 4.98 grams of KOH per cubic decimeter. That's grams, KOH, per cubic decimeter. Okay. Here's a different experiment I'm going to leave you with, different question I'm going to leave you with. Pause the slide here and have a look at this. So this is reaction between potassium hydroxide and an acid HX. So we do not know on this occasion what the H is. It could be chloride, hydrochloric acid, nitrate as in nitric acid, sulphate. It couldn't be sulphate because there it would be H2X. So you've been given information here. This acid is in the form of a solid, and 1.10 grams of the acid was taken. In a titration, potassium hydroxide was used, and you have its concentration 0.5 moles per cubic decimeter. And we're told that it took 25 cubic centimeters, sorry about that, 25 cubic centimeters to neutralize this acid. 1.10 grams of this acid. Now, could you work out the number of moles of potassium hydroxide that was used on the basis that the volume was 25 and the concentration 0.5? Do you recall that concentration is expressed in mole per cubic decimeter? And therefore, if we want moles, we cover moles and read off what is left. So moles is equal to the concentration multiplied by the dm cubed. We will have to change this volume into cubic decimeters, and that's 0.025 dm cubed. So the concentration then is 0.5 times the volume in cubic decimeters, 0.025. And this gives us the number of moles, so it'll be 0.0125 moles of KOH, 0.0125 moles. Now they react in the ratio 1 mole to 1 mole. How do I know that? From this equation. So the number of moles of HX will be the same. We'll also have 0.0125 mole of HX. Equals that number of grams. So how would we work out what 1 mole of HX would weigh? Well, what we do is, if I divided this number by itself, and I then do the same to the other side of the equation, if I divide this by itself, clearly a number divided by itself is 1, so that would be 1 mole. So what I'm going to do is divide this by the same number, 0.0125. And according to my reckoning, that comes out to be 88, which means that 1 mole of this chemical would weigh 88 grams. The RM then of HX is 88. If we had been asked, the H contributes 1 to the mass. So they add up to a total of 88. So the X then, given that the hydrogen contributes 1, the X part of it must be 88 minus 1, or 87. Now that's not necessarily one element, we don't know, like in nitric acid, nitrate is a combination of several atoms. So I'm just going to leave it like that. Okay, that was again quite lengthy, but we've covered several different types of questions there, and hopefully your skills have built up. I don't have answers to these, so if I should have made a slip up somewhere, then perhaps you'll let me know. Once again, thanks for listening, and consider going on then to take a look at the next Snapcast, which will be entitled Moles 5 and 6.